Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, Mario Ritter Jr. has a report on big technology companies and their push to secure clean energy. Then, Jill Robbins presents this week's education report. We close the show with the lesson of the day from Jill Robbins and Andrew Smith. But first,
technology company Amazon recently said it is investing in small nuclear reactors to meet its increasing need for electricity. Amazon's announcement came 2 days after a similar statement from technology company Google. Nuclear power is gaining attention as the owner of the Three Mile Island Nuclear Power Station in Pennsylvania announced last month that it will restart the reactor there. The goal is to sell the energy from the nuclear station to Microsoft to power its huge data centers. All three companies, Microsoft, Amazon, and Google, operate large data centers. They have been spending a lot of money on solar and wind power to create and use electricity that does not produce greenhouse gases. However, their energy needs are so great that they need to find other ways to produce clean energy. Nuclear energy does not create greenhouse gases. The International Energy Agency in Paris predicts that data centers will use 1,000 terawatts of electricity in 2026. 1 terawatt is equal to 1 million megawatts. That is double the amount from 2022. Data centers are important to artificial intelligence, or AI, systems. AI tools use huge amounts of information to learn to do things in a way that is almost human. Kevin Miller is an official with Amazon Web Services. Miller told the Associated Press, AI is driving a significant increase in the amount of data centers and power that are required on the grid. He said adding nuclear power was very important. Small modular reactors can generate up to one-third of the power that a traditional nuclear reactor can. Recently, U.S. Energy Secretary Jennifer Granholm spoke at Amazon's second headquarters in Virginia. Speaking of energy production, Granholm said, "Modular reactors are a huge piece of how we're going to solve this puzzle." Granholm said the department will provide $900 million to produce more reactors. Developers say small reactors can be built faster and at a lower cost than large reactors. The developers say they will be able to produce electricity by the early 2030s if the Nuclear Regulatory Commission gives them permission. Catherine Huff is a nuclear engineering professor at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign and former official at the U.S. Department of Energy. Huff said, "If new clean power is not added as data centers expand, the U.S. risks browning the grid, or including more power from sources that are not clean, coal, oil, and gas. Small modular reactors are currently under development. They reportedly do not provide power to the U.S. grid. However, big investors can help them develop. Huff said the recent announcements could be an inflection point or a sign that things are changing. A professor of nuclear engineering at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, Jacopo Bongiorno, said the industry needs buyers who value dependable and clean energy. They only have to be willing to pay more for it, at first, until the cost comes down. On October 14th, Google said it signed an agreement with Kairos Power, based in Alameda, California. Google said it would buy energy from several small modular reactors. Google said it expects the first modular reactors to start operations by 2030, with additional ones coming through the year 2035. The deal is expected to generate 500 megawatts of electricity. However, Google's own environmental report estimated that the company used 24 terawatts of electricity last year. Amazon's October 16th announcement said the company was working with Dominion Energy to study building modular reactors near the North Anna nuclear station in Virginia. The company said it is investing in X Energy, a reactor developer based in Maryland. Amazon is also working with Energy Northwest in Washington State. The combined deals could produce 5,000 megawatts of power by the late 2030s. However, that is likely a small part of Amazon's total power use, which it does not release to the public. Doug True is an official with the Nuclear Energy Institute, an industry group. He said new reactor designs could meet industrial needs because of their small size and dependability. It seems like a really good fit to support those facilities, and for a lot of different applications, depending upon the amount of power that's needed by the customer, True said. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
For many years, children of families living in the United States illegally have had the right to attend public school based on a 1982 Supreme Court decision. The justices said it is unconstitutional to deny children an education based on their immigration status. But conservative politicians in states such as Oklahoma, Texas, and Tennessee are now questioning that right. They also raise the possibility of challenging the decision known as Plyler versus Doe. The Supreme Court's conservative majority has already overturned previous decisions on abortion rights and the use of race for admissions in higher education. Supporters of the 1982 decision fear it could become a national issue if former President Donald Trump wins a second term in the White House. Trump has made immigration a central part of his 2024 presidential campaign. He promises to carry out the largest operation in history to expel immigrants from the country if elected. The debate over welcoming immigrant children into public schools has also reached the small town of Saugus near Boston, Massachusetts. At a recent meeting, the Saugus Public Schools Committee approved a new admissions policy. The policy requires new students to share immigration records. Families must sign a residency statement and provide housing and identity documents. It said the purpose was to simplify the process of registering students. But some are criticizing the policy's requirement for proof of legal residency and the threat of criminal and civil punishment for violators. They say it has another goal: keeping immigrants out of the small town's schools. Civil rights lawyers say the Saugus requirements are too difficult for all to complete and violate federal law. They say the requirements unfairly harm students from immigrant families. They say even those living in the country legally may lack many of the required documents. Vincent Cirino is head of the Saugus School Committee. He said during the August meeting that the policy is tightening up of existing residency rules and not intended to keep out immigrants. But a Nicaraguan woman told the Associated Press that it took 6 months to register her 8-year-old child because of the document requirements. The woman said the town would not accept her housing papers, and the school did not answer when she spoke about the problems. In Saugus, the number of students who learn English has grown to 31% over the last 10 years. In 2021, the national average for English learners in public schools was 10%, with the highest being Texas schools at 20%. The increase in the number of immigrants in public schools makes it necessary to make changes in order to serve larger numbers of English learners. But until recently, educators and officials would not have accepted the idea of denying children an education. Tom K. Wong is director of the U.S. Immigration Policy Center at the University of California, San Diego. He said that now such ideas are becoming accepted in certain political circles. Earlier this year, the Conservative Heritage Foundation urged states to pass laws requiring public schools to ask families living in the country illegally to pay for their children to attend. Over the summer, Ryan Walters, head of Oklahoma's State Department of Education, said his agency would ask schools to collect information on the cost of illegal immigration. Several school systems have pushed back, saying they will not check students' immigration status. Chris Payne is a spokesperson for Union Public Schools in Tulsa, Oklahoma. He said federal law bans schools from asking students or their families about their immigration status or to request documentation of their citizenship. Attempts to limit children of immigrants in public schools have also failed in the states of Tennessee and Texas so far. Back in Massachusetts, legal experts say the policy has been a problem for at least two immigrant families trying to register children in Saugus schools. And it took their involvement to get the students into the school. The policy itself is illegal, said Oren Selstrom of Lawyers for Civil Rights. Schools should be welcoming all children who are in the district and educating them. I'm Jill Robbins.
Jill Robbins is here now to talk more about that education report. Hi, Jill. Thanks for joining me. Could you explain a little more about this term, immigration status?
It means whether or not you have a legal right to live in the country. Many of the new immigrants to the U.S. have a temporary status that allows them to live here because their home country is too dangerous.
But they can change that status, right?
Yes, there is a long process to becoming an American citizen. For most, it takes at least 5 years.
What if a person does not have legal status as an immigrant?
Then you can say they are undocumented. Simply put, they do not have the documents to stay here legally. But many of those people have children who need to be in school. Our laws require public schools to accept them, no matter whether their parents have legal immigration documents. There, they can learn English and everything else children need to know.
All right. Thanks so much for joining me today, Jill, and thank you for that report.
Thank you, Ashley. It's always my pleasure.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
My name is Anna Mateo.
My name is Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In lesson 40, Anna is trying something new. Acting on the stage. She tells us why she is making this change in her career. Let's listen.
Happy New Year! Some people, at the start of a new year, make a resolution, a promise to yourself to be better. I thought about my resolution carefully. I want to be an actor on the stage! Today, I will audition for a show called The Woods Are Alive. Wish me luck. Next!
What is your name?
My name is Anna Mateo.
Are you ready to audition?
Yes.
Great. Let's begin on page one. Here is the story. You are lost in the woods. You are searching desperately for a way out. Suddenly, you hear something. Now say your line.
What was that? Hello? Is someone there?
Anna is at an audition. This word is like another word our listeners may know, audio, coming from the Latin root meaning to hear, An audition is when someone does a kind of interview for a part in a play or as a singer or dancer. Anna says she is doing this because of her New Year's resolution or a decision to make a change in her life. The New Year is coming up soon on the Western calendar. Andrew, do you usually make New Year's resolutions or promises to yourself?
Well, I have learned not to make big resolutions at New Year's because those can be very difficult to follow. Instead, I've learned to make small ones. Those are easier to keep, like folding all my clothes and putting them away.
I don't make resolutions, but I do think it's a good idea to stop now and then to take stock of your life, to think of what you'd like to change about it, and make a plan to help yourself make those changes.
That's an interesting expression you used, Jill, to take stock of. That means to think carefully about something so you can make a decision about what to do next. Anna said she wants to be an actor. Let's listen and find out what happens when she tries to get an acting job.
Hello? Is someone there?
Anna, you are speaking too softly. Can you speak more loudly and a little more, seriously?
What was that? Hello? Is someone there? Is that loud enough?
Yes. Yes, that is loud enough.
This lesson gives us some good advice on speaking in front of a group, like an actor does, or anyone giving a speech or a presentation needs to do. In the pronunciation practice video for lesson 40, you can find that advice. The key words you need for understanding this section are lungs, that's the organs that fill with air when you breathe, and diaphragm, the muscle below your lungs that helps pull air into the lungs and pushes the air out when you speak.
Often, English teachers ask students to give a class presentation. As adults, we may need to give a formal speech. To speak well to a group, you must learn to talk at a louder level and send your voice farther. One way to improve is to learn how to use a part of your body called the diaphragm.
Many English learners are afraid to speak loudly. That's because they are not sure that what they are saying is correct. When you speak in front of a group, you should practice many times so you are more confident about what you are saying. Then you can learn to speak from the diaphragm, the muscle that pushes the air out of your lungs.
You can learn to speak from your diaphragm. This will help you to send your voice out clearly and loudly so that your audience can hear you better. As an exercise, stand up straight and put your hand on your abdomen. Feel it go in and out when you breathe.
Breathe in and count to five. One, two, three, four, five. Breathe out and say ah.
Ah.
One, two, three, four, five.
Do you feel relaxed? You want to be breathing and speaking from that relaxed state.
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast from Voice of America. That is good advice, to tell students to breathe deeply before they begin a presentation. It helps them relax and speak louder, too. Say, Jill, as a teacher, did you have to learn this technique?
I sure did, and it wasn't easy for me. I spoke so softly, people always used to tell me to speak up. Let's find out if Anna learns this lesson.
Yes. Yes, that is loud enough. Okay, let's turn to page 25. In this scene, you are moving slowly and quietly through the woods. Anna! Anna! You are walking quickly and loudly. Walk slowly and quietly.
I am walking slowly and quietly. I am walking.
Anna, Anna, you don't need to say slowly and quietly. All right. Let's try the last scene. Turn to page 48. I say my line first, then you say your line. You will never get out of these woods alive!
Yes, I will.
Okay, Anna, you said that line. You said that line really late. You need to say it earlier.
Sorry. Let me try again.
Now we've come to another problem. Timing. When you're acting, you have to pay attention to the other actors in the play and say your lines at the right time.
I used to have that same problem with students. They didn't listen when other students in the class spoke, so they asked the same questions that had just been asked. I think the director in our lesson has learned to give every new actor a chance, though. Let's find out what she tells Anna after her audition.
You will never...
Yes, I will!
...get out of the woods alive.
I was too early, wasn't I?
Yes. Yes, you were.
Director, how am I doing?
You know, Anna, I think I have the perfect part for you. The costume is in the back. Please go try it on.
Awesome!
Oh, Anna, that fits you perfectly.
I'm a tree. I'm a tree. In the woods are alive! Yes! My new year is starting awesomely! Excuse me, director. I have a great idea for my tree. Oh, wait. Till next time.
Once again, let me tell our listeners, Anna comes out on stage in a cardboard tree costume. You may have seen this in other videos, since Anna loves to wear it.
Yes, it's in Lesson 17 of Let's Learn English with Anna as a family tree.
And Let's Learn English with Anna is our program for younger learners on the Learning English website. Well, I'm afraid we're almost out of time now. How about writing to us to tell us when you tried something new, as we saw Anna do in this lesson? Send us an email at learningenglish@voanews.com or comment on our YouTube video.
Remember, you can find us on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, or our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. We hope you have enjoyed the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Dr. Jill.
Thanks for listening. I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.